Welcome to the Blue Christmas service at the church at Ponce and Highland. And the message is simple. It is okay not to be okay this time of year. Christmas can be hard. And this is a sacred space for everyone who is not feeling quite so jolly or overjoyed. This is a time for grief and fear and anger, and hopefully we will find some courage and some hope in there too. So tonight, we will light four candles, and after each candle lighting, we will sing a verse of Silent Night together. At the end of the service, we will have an opportunity to light some individual candles as we lift up prayers to God. And I should note, for those of you watching online, there is a link in the description of the Facebook Live video with a copy of our hymns, the order of worship, and a copy of the Silent Night version that we will be singing this evening. So, before we begin, will you join me in prayer? God of grace, you will find no fake smiles here, no happy faces for the benefit of others. You will only find us. Real and raw, and maybe even brokenhearted. You will find us turning our faces to you and lifting up our laments. Grant us, O God, a taste of your presence, so that we may trust that the God of all beginnings and endings hears our cries and cries with us. Help us to remember, O God, tonight that we never weep alone. Amen. So now will you please join me in the call to worship, which I hope you have had a chance to find on online or which is printed in your bulletin. And you please stand as able and do so. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." And so we invite each other to this time of peaceful worship. Tonight we come looking for the Christ child. We come bringing our hurts, our fear, our anger. We come seeking relief from pain, anxiety, loneliness, and despair. With the psalmist of the scriptures, we say, "O Lord, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living. Give heed to my cry, for I am low." We come tonight to rest in God. Amen. Now, will you please join us in singing?
You will join me in singing hymn number 76, O Come, Emmanuel.
Until the Son of God appears. The first candle represents our grief at loss and heartbreak. Hear these words from Psalm 13. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I bear pain in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all day long? The Word of God. Grief slips into our lives without warning. It folds a crease into our lives, a before and after, the time with and the time without. Before and after, laughter and tears, one understanding of who we are and another. Whether we grieve a person, a job, or our health, whatever the shape and texture of our loss, our days are different. Somehow grief is both impossibly vast and unbearably specific. It is an unpluggable hole at the center of our being, and also missing the sound of a person's voice or the way they laughed. The routine of getting up in the morning for a job we don't have anymore, or driving past a house that reminds us of a place we once called home. We grieve what we have lost. We get angry at weird, awkward moments and shrink inside ourselves. Tears spring unbidden. We get tired of people asking us how we are holding up, even if we dread the day people no longer ask. And we weep. We weep for people, for broken dreams, for the plan we once had. We weep for the loss of income, the loss of relationships, for all that feels missing in our lives. Jill Bialowski writes, "I consider grief a forever thing. It returns in different waves of intensity, but it never fully goes away. Though we can smooth out the lines and write new pages of our story, we cannot forget. This season has a way of crashing powerful waves upon the shores of our hearts. We want so badly to be joyful, but every carol and every string of lights reminds us of that forever thing. Sometimes it feels like the emptiness is big enough that we could fall in and never find our way out. Our grief is a big, ugly, lumpy weight on our shoulders, grinding us down and leaving us out of breath. O God of mercy, if we shrugged this weight off our shoulders, would you hold it for us for a moment? Healer God, will you hem the edges of the holes inside us so we cease to unravel. Loving God, will you shed tears alongside us, weeping for all that was and is no more? God of infinite grace, if we lit a candle for every broken heart, would there be anything left but flame? Or would you swallow the flames, transmute them, and make of them instead a new star in the Bethlehem sky? The first candle represents our grief. As we light this candle, we bear our broken hearts to God, knowing that to be brokenhearted is to be alive, and that God's heart breaks alongside us. We offer our grief to God with the lighting of this candle.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child. Holy infant, so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace.
The second candle represents our fear. Hear now these words from Romans 8. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. There are times when we grieve and there are times when we get angry, but if we dive beneath the surface of this turbulent water, we find lurking deep in our hearts a cold fear, wearing the face of a thousand questions. What will be life like without the one that I miss? What will happen if I get sick or I lose my job? What will happen with the loved one who is sick? Will I receive forgiveness? Can I forgive myself? Will I be able to pay this month's rent? Will I stay sober? Will my kids be safe at school? Will I survive this illness? Or what will happen if they ask me for my papers? Or can I get pulled over by a cop? What will happen if they ask me who I love? What will happen to all of us in the face of a changing climate? The unknown always confronts us as one part adventure and one part interruption, one part big, scary obstacle. We plan, we prepare, we circle dates on calendars, and yet we always stumble across the brute reality of time, the fact that tomorrow flows on into our life as this overwhelming whirl of possibilities. When fear offers us this illusion of control, as if we can think a future into existence, while it actually sneakily controls us instead. Fear refuses to remain part of the journey, but insists on leading the way. And though there are some of us with the perfect blend of brain chemicals that make worrying just so easy, all of us know fear because all of us know uncertainty. There are questions we cannot answer. There are outcomes we cannot determine. We are comfortable with beginnings. We thrive on middles. But the unknown at the end of all things, we fear this. So, God of calm and quiet, will you fill us with deep breaths? Let us drink of your peace as if it is a cool glass of water on a hot Georgia day, so different from the weather outside right now. God, let our fear make us kind instead of cruel, more compassionate instead of more calloused, more empathetic instead of more angry. Let us find bravery inside our fear. Let us make friends with our fear and walk with it, knowing that you walk alongside us, that is the story of the Christ child. Lift our eyes to the manger, O Lord, and remind us that nothing separates us from your love, not even fear. And so the second candle represents our fear, and as we light this candle, we pour out to God everything that leaves us uncertain and afraid, no matter how big or how small, how likely or unlikely, all of it, because God accepts all of it. We remember that God walks with us with the lighting of this candle.
Silent night, holy night, griefs abound ever in sight. Christ now comes in manger bare, holds our pain in his holy joy at last to be ours, joy at last to be ours.
Our third candle represents our anger. Our Creator endowed us with a myriad of emotions, including anger, which we righteously feel toward hatred, abuse, injustice. Hear these words from Jeremiah 8. We look for peace, but find no good, for a time of healing, but there is terror instead. The snorting of their horses is heard from Dan. At the sound of the neighing of their stallions, the whole land quakes. They come to devour the land and all that fills it, the city and those who live in it. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then has the health of my poor people not been restored? The word of God. Tonight, as we gather, you can't tell me that anger is wrong. Don't tell me that anger is not welcome, even in this sacred space that we share. When creation was heralded as good, and we, as God's image, were called very good, yet this world, this culture, does not match the promises of God. Here, hatred, abuse, injustice, and violence persist. So don't tell me that anger isn't welcome. When we see suffering in war and despotism, when we hear the thunder of tanks and bombs being dropped on innocents, when we fail to share our abundance with the lost and the hungry, when we see school children cowering under desks, when a man is murdered and his office burned to the ground for doing his job, we have known loss that we don't deserve, seen suffering that should not have been, and our hearts are broken. Our hope is deferred. when there are human beings with no choice but to sleep outside, especially on these cold nights leading up to Christmas, when families flee their homelands just for safety, when creation is exploited, when we worry more about right belief instead of our gay neighbor, when we witness the exploitation of women and the trafficking of children for sexual profit, when we cannot forgive our own mistakes that still haunt us from the past, when, as Paul states in Romans 7, for what I want to do, I do not do, but I do what I hate to do, when God seems so far and absent from our daily lives, don't tell me it's not right to be angry. Instead, tell me that anger is welcome. Tell me that a righteous anger, an anger that sees the darkness in the world, is acceptable, but only for a little while. Anger may and should come to visit our hearts, but it can't stay. It shouldn't take residence. Anger may burn for a short time, but it should be extinguished by our hope in Christ. We shouldn't rebuke anger or ignore it or say it's wrong. We should greet it like a God-given, precious, holy friend who comes to visit but then needs to leave. We will not make anger our daily bread or rely on it for fuel, because we know our Creator's call to love, and love cannot flourish in anger. So we will release our anger, let it float away on the wind. We will hand it over to God, who will hold it for us until it's safe for us to come close to it again. So tell me anger is welcome here too, but only for a moment, only until the dawn. So tonight we light the third candle, which represents our anger, a gift that flows from the gap between the world as God made it and dreamed it, and the world as it is. As we light this candle, we offer God all the injustice and suffering that angers us, and we release our anger to God with the lighting of this candle.
Silent night, holy night, shepherds quake at the sight, glory streak from heaven afar.
Let us pray together. God of love, in this Christmas season, one of anticipation that is mixed with confusion and loss, we come together seeking comfort. We seek your presence to break through our loneliness, remembering that sorrow is not the absence of joy, but a shadow that keeps it from view. For sorrow can feel like a scar on the heart that stays with us even as the experience of love returns, but returns to a life that has been changed and altered and sobered by experience. As we realize that our relationships that may be fewer now seem resonant with more depth. So we ask for your blessing this night upon all those who mourn, for the pain at Christmas seems sharper. And we remember the words of Jesus who promised comfort to those who mourn, saying, "Come to me, all you who are struggling and carrying heavy loads, and I will give you rest. May we rest in your words. And may we not rush to the language of healing before understanding the fullness of the injury and the depth of the wound. Lord, let us not rush to offer a Band-Aid when the gaping wound requires surgery. Help us to listen for the deeper story, for the many stories, even if they are painful to hear. And Lord, let us believe one another when we talk about our pain, even if it's not the same pain that we know. Let us see together that systems are broken, that relationships are broken. Help us to be the healing we wish to see in the world. Guide us now, O Holy One, that we might move in still small steps from mourning to comfort. Help us to find the healing in the midst of the pain, to find order in the midst of chaos. Help us now to rest in your presence. And tonight, as we light these candles, we are reminded that your dream for this world involves the end of tears and a joy that continuously overflows. So may these little flames that we light burn bright, and may our hearts be open again to sing and maybe one day to dance. May we laugh and love again. Lord, may we sow joy in this hurting world, and may all these acts be acts of holy resistance. For all this we pray, in the name of the one who was born in a manger. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
The fourth candle represents our courage. Hear now these words from Isaiah 65. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. From outside the field, planting a seed seems foolish. Bent down in the dirt and grime, with sweat on your brow and an ache in your back, to sow what you may not reap. Placing the future into the earth as the sky grows dark and the year grows lean. Starting tomorrow, this seed is on its own. Then comes wind and rain and snow and tempest, the sun's dry heat like an open oven, icy wind crashing down like a wave. I can tend to my seed, I can guard it, but only life directs its path from here. And life, as we know, is often beautiful, but rarely kind. From outside the field, planting a seed seems foolish. But what you do not know is that I plant myself alongside this seed, 1 foot for hopes and 1 foot for dreams, in the wind and rain and storm and tempest, in the sun and in the icy wind. My dream seed and I will reach out wide and see glimpses of sun and not just clouds. For life, we know, is always beautiful with the courage to see it. I plant myself here in the richest and darkest soils, perfumed with the dreams of 1,000 generations, the hope that moved mountains and parted seas, nourished, renewed, replenished, re-energized from a river that flows from a long ago yesterday to a great sea that only tomorrow can find. In the midst of wind and rain and storm and tempest, I find my next breath in this dirt. I find my courage. So from outside the field, planting a seed seems foolish. Bent down in the dirt and grime, with sweat on your brow and an ache in your back, to sow what you may not reap. Placing the future into the earth as the sky grows dark and the year grows lean. But inside this field, I summon God's courage to bend and plant a seed and dream. The fourth candle represents our courage, and as we light this candle, we draw from God the courage to confront our sorrow, to share our feelings honestly, to comfort each other when needed. The courage to take our heartbreak and our fear, our anger, and to let them make us more loving, more compassionate, more kind, for that is the call of the Christ child we await this Christmas. And as we wait through these dark, cold nights, daring to hope in spite of our pain, we remember God and God's unfailing love for each of us and for this whole aching world. A love born in Christ on Christmas. We do all this with the lighting of this fourth candle.
Yeah.
Now, as Chris sings and Lisa plays, I invite you to step forward and light a candle of your own, whether it be in memory of someone or in order to hand over to God something that rests heavy on your heart. Come listen, come light a candle, and join us.
To stand as you're able or willing as we sing hymn number 98, I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day.
Before we go, if you'll permit me a moment, late on Friday night, a gentleman passed away on the steps of our church. It was not an act of violence. He had been living outside for some time. People said that he had been sick for a few weeks or maybe longer, and they don't really know the cause. He didn't have identification on him. So we don't know who he was or what happened or what his whole story is, but we do know that he was a child of God and a beloved one. So if you'll just take a moment of silence with me in honor of his memory before I offer a benediction. Thank you. And in lieu of a benediction, I want to share a short poem by Howard Thurman titled, I Will Light Candles This Christmas. Candles of joy despite all sadness. Candles of hope where despair keeps watch. Candles of courage for fears ever present. Candles of peace for tempest-tossed days. Candles of grace to ease heavy burdens. Candles of love to inspire all my living. Candles that will burn all the year long. Be human, be kind, be both. Amen.